Thank you. Good morning. I'd like to call this a joint hearing of the Committee on Transportation Infrastructure and also the Committee on Oversight and Government Reform to order. Today, the topic of the hearing is America's presidential libraries, their mission and their future. The order of business today will be opening statements by members, and then we'll turn to our panel. Let me say at the outset, this is probably one of the more unique hearings in Congress, and that is today going to focus on a unique subject, and that's, again, the mission, the future of our presidential libraries. And we decided to do that jointly. Our committee has some responsibility, legislative responsibility, under the economic development, public buildings, and emergency management subcommittee. Also, the important government reform and oversight committee, chaired by my colleague, the gentleman from California, has very important legislative and oversight responsibility over presidential libraries. So a rather unique subject and a unique approach. I might say at the outset, this isn't one of these hearings where we have a mission of some violation or some problem with the libraries. This is, I think, a very forward-looking hearing in trying to assess the current status of our presidential libraries and also their important mission and then their future. It's impossible to have all of them in this panel, and today's formal hearing is a representation, and we've got a good, I think, cross-section of some of those involved with the presidential libraries that we'll hear from shortly. I want to thank again Chairman Issa, Chairman Gowdy of the subcommittee, who has say over this also in, again, in government reform. Ms. Norton and Mr. Rahal isn't with us today, but enjoyed his support in having this joint hearing. The other gentleman that has joined us, of course, is Mr. Cummings, and I've had the great honor and privilege of working with him both as a chair and also as a ranking member in the past, and appreciate his support on government reform and the relationship we've shared over the years. So that's a little bit about our mission. Let me say a couple of things. First of all, most folks don't realize we have some publicly funded and sponsored presidential libraries, and we also have some private libraries. Many of them start out with private donations and end up in the public realm. I've had the opportunity to visit some of the libraries across the nation, and found it one of the most rewarding experiences that I could enjoy. I like a little bit of history like most folks, but it really gives the public, academia, and students, and people who are interested in the history of the United States and our presidents great access, information, and a tremendous resource, a national treasure. The question of why we should have this hearing is really there are a whole host of questions that need to be answered about how we proceed. Right now we are in tough economic times. The federal government, sometimes some of the libraries that depend on private donations, have also experienced some downturns, both in visitors and in revenues. And then the important question, again, before us is their future mission, how that changes and evolves, and what the federal role of participation with these libraries is. In talking with the Librarian of Congress, I didn't realize this, but I believe he told me that presidential papers from, I guess, Washington through up to Hoover are handled by the Library of Congress and, I guess, the National Archives. And then we began the construction and creation of presidential libraries. There are a host of questions, as I said, that we hope to answer today. We probably won't get to all of them in this formal hearing. One of the things I like to do, in addition to formal hearings, is have an informal session. And this afternoon, beginning, I believe it's around 2:30, we'll begin over in the Cannon Caucus Room, a symposium. And we hope that those other representatives of both the public and private presidential libraries, we know they'll be joining us, and we won't have quite as formal a discussion as we'll have with the panel before us today. Again, the panel is only representative of all of you who've come today from across the country representing some of these great institutions. So in that symposium and forum, and it's open to members of Congress too, and any of the public, it is a public event, we'll have an opportunity to ask some questions, get some, hopefully a good exchange and commentary on some of the questions that will be raised at the hearing today, and again, the important mission that these libraries have. We again thank all of those who've come today. I've had a chance to visit a few of the libraries, the Truman, the Roosevelt, the Nixon, the Reagan, the Kennedy, the Hoover, and I think most recently the Lincoln also, a variety of public and private endeavors. And again, just an incredible opportunity for the public to walk through again and see and review and have access to the history of our leaders over the course of many generations. So again, that's the purpose of the formal hearing this morning, the symposium that we'll have this afternoon, a unique opportunity in Congress to sit down and again look at where we are and where we're going with one of our important national treasures and assets that we are the custodians of as far as members of Congress and leaders again, our respective libraries. So with that, let me turn, if I may, to the gentlelady from the District of Columbia, Ms. Norton, for an opening statement.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I'm going to say just a few words and ask to submit my opening statement for the record. I look forward to learning more about the presidential libraries. As a member of both committees, your own Transportation Infrastructure Committee and the Committee of Jurisdiction, Oversight and Government Reform, I note that there are a large number of visitors to these libraries, over 2 million, that President Roosevelt built the first, and ever since then, apparently every president has felt he must have a presidential library. But it wasn't until 1955 that the federal government understood it was dealing with federal history, federal papers, and of course, the Presidential Libraries Act was passed. The relationship of these libraries to their foundations creates something of a hybrid within the federal system, so oversight is certainly appropriate. They have their own foundations, which of course are responsible for building these libraries, but these are official documents of the people of the United States. And this committee or the Congress has a very appropriate role. I ask that my statement be submitted to the record.
Without objection, and now let me yield to the co-chair of this joint hearing, a gentleman who chairs the Government Reform and Oversight Committee of the House of Representatives from California, Mr. Issa. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thanks for holding this joint hearing. As you said earlier, many of us on the dais serve on both hearings, so I have members of my committee who are sitting here in two roles, just as Ms. Norton and Mr. Cummings are both sitting here in two roles. There is a difference in the oversight that we'll be looking at today. There's no question that for the Transportation Infrastructure Committee, they are looking at the economic impact, the federal assets themselves, the non, if you will, paper, if you will, federal assets, particularly the facilities. In a case of our committee, we're looking at a combination of highest and best use for the federal dollar. The cost of paying 100% of the cost of archivist at each of these facilities, and the cost of basically about 45% being the federal government and state government's contribution through to, because of tax deductibility for charities, of the other side. So the truth is the taxpayers are paying for these facilities on both sides. I think all of us on the dais believe it's money well spent, but it's money that has to be looked at carefully. If there were no presidential libraries, there is no question that there would be hundreds of thousands of entities involved in every nuance of maintaining those records, pouring through them. On the other hand, it could be that they would be more available as a researcher would want to look through ancient records. There's no question that each of the libraries has a natural struggle, one in which the followers and descendants of a president, and the president himself, if he's still alive, wants to maintain a positive legacy. Everything that happened on their watch was good. Well, in fact, history may show that there were gaping flaws from Jefferson to Nixon, and then we'll stay away from those beyond. There have been scandals, and those scandals can, in fact, and may, in fact, be appropriate to have seen within a library. But let's understand there's a balance. Our presidents represent, for the most part, progress in a number, in many, many areas, even among the most, if you will, failed or least popular presidents. Additionally, our committee has, over the last many years, under both Republican and Democratic leadership, had a particular interest in inventory control at the libraries, access to researchers at libraries, and especially protected records, which is a nice way for classified. Presidents operate at the highest level of secrecy, and as a result, a great part of what goes on during a president's life is, in fact, classified for 50 years or more. We need to have that protected both from premature release, but we also need to make sure that when the time is right, it can be released. Our committee has, over the years, had a number of legitimate concerns with information that is gone and will never be found, or at least won't be found in our lifetime. So today's hearing is about hearing the good news and hearing from people who have a vested interest in their library doing well while meeting this challenge that Congress has given to primarily the private sector in support of their foundation. With that, I'll put the rest in for the record and yield back.
Thank you so much, Mr. Issa. And let me yield now to the gentleman from Maryland, Mr. Cummings.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and Chairman Issa, to Ranking Member Norton. I appreciate you for holding this hearing today on presidential libraries. This is an issue that is very important to the Oversight Committee because we have jurisdiction over the National Archives and Records Administration and the laws that govern presidential libraries. I look forward to working on these issues with Chairman Issa and Chairman Gowdy in his role as Chairman of the Subcommittee with jurisdiction over the National Archives, as well as with the Ranking Member of that Subcommittee, Danny Davis. And Chairman Mica, this hearing and the other events you have planned today provide a great opportunity to highlight our presidential libraries. Presidential libraries play a critical role in making presidential papers and artifacts available to researchers. These libraries also bring history to life for thousands of visitors each year. Most of the libraries operated by the National Archives also have a private foundation that sponsors their own programs and activities. Representative Lacey Clay, in his role last year as chairman of the Subcommittee on Information Policy, Census and National Archives requested that the Government Accountability Office examine the laws and policies related to the presidential libraries and the private library foundations. GAO is issuing a report today that provides a helpful description of the three primary laws that address presidential libraries and the regulations and policies covering the relationships between libraries and private library foundations. I ask that this report be made a part of the hearing record. And an interesting aspect of presidential libraries is the relationship between libraries and the private library foundations. We are fortunate to have President Roosevelt's granddaughter here today. It was President Roosevelt who first had the idea for a privately built but federally maintained library to house his presidential papers. The Presidential Libraries Act of 1955 formally established a policy for privately built presidential libraries to be transferred to the federal government. Subsequent laws established reporting and design requirements and some limitations, such as requiring an operating endowment for each library, starting with the George H.W. Bush Library. Finally, Mr. Chairman, the relationship between libraries and private foundations provide many benefits, but also can raise potential issues. For example, the sharing of space within the same facilities create questions about the proper use of library facilities, especially for political activities. In addition, donations provided by the private sector to private foundations to fund the building of these libraries are private. GAO reports that each library has a written agreement with its associated foundation, but the detail and scope of these agreements vary from library to library. GAO found that over time, the agreements have become increasingly more detailed regarding staff, how library facilities can be used, and political activities with regard to political activities. Some recent agreements also address potential conflicts of interest between the library and the foundation. And so, and one of the things that I'll be interested to hear is the continuing resolution recently passed by the House provides $32 million less for the National Archives than was enacted for fiscal year 2010, and almost $16 million less than the President's request for fiscal year 2011. I would love to know how our witnesses believe that those cuts are going to affect, if at all, the activities in those libraries, and just give us some information with regard to where you think our priorities may be. So often we spend a lot of time cutting and cutting and cutting, but we cut off our past, and it's kind of difficult to know your past if you don't know your future and deal with your future if you don't have a history of your past. And so I consider these libraries very, very important. I appreciate the guests being here today. And with that, Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Thank you. And with the request by the gentleman for record, he referred to be made part of the record without objection, so ordered. Thank you. Let me yield now to the Chair of the Economic Development, Public Buildings, and Emergency Management Subcommittee, a gentleman from California, Mr. Denham. You're recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to thank you for holding this hearing on this very important subject with the relationship between federal government and our nation's public and private presidential libraries. As you know, in California, I've got both the Nixon and Reagan libraries. The public benefit provided by these institutions is invaluable to the history of this nation and to the insight they provide to the decisions that help shape our country. I look forward to hearing from our witnesses testimony on not only the mission and future direction of the presidential libraries, but also on the funding aspect. Thank you.
Other members seek recognition. Ms. Johnson, Mr. O. Okay. Gentleman from, see, Mr. Gowdy. You chair one of the subcommittees.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman. I want to commend you and Chairman Issa for this extraordinary hearing and what is, I believe, going to be an extraordinary day, given the expertise, the amalgamation of experience that we have. I would rather hear from the witnesses and hear the questions than hear myself talk, so I would yield back.
Thank you so much. Other members seek recognition? Okay. No other members seek recognition. Then again, what we'll do is go to our panel of witnesses, and I'm going to ask Mr. Issa if he would introduce the first three witnesses and have them recognized. We don't have to swear these folks in today, Mr. Issa. I guess normally you do that on your panel, but
I think we can waive that since we're in your hearing room.
Thank you. Thank you. Well, you're recognized to recognize
thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Panelists. Thank you.
Our first witness is the Honorable David S. Ferraro, the Archivist of the United States. And probably the most important part of today's hearing really has a great deal to do with how the National Archives and Record Administration can, in fact, oversee all but one of the people here in their organizations. Our second witness is Thomas Putman, Director of the John F. Kennedy Presidential Library and Museum. And our third, Mr. Duke Blackwell, Director of the Ronald Reagan Library and a fairly constant host to me when I get up there.
We'll start out by recognizing the
Archivist. No, you have three more to introduce.
I'll catch those when we get to them. But we'll go ahead, and what we're going to do is we'll have the first three give their testimony. We try to limit you to 5 minutes. If you have a lengthy statement or anything you'd like to have included in the record, that will be part of the made part of the proceedings today. But first, we'll recognize Mr. Ferraro.
By the way, if David asks to have something put in the record, make sure it's not all of his archives. That could be over our limit.
Well, we'll make note of that. Thank you, and you're recognized. Welcome, sir.
Chairman Mica, Chairman Issa, and members of the committees, I appreciate the opportunity to testify before you today on the important role of the presidential libraries, both to the nation and to their local communities. Presidential libraries preserve, interpret, and present the history of American democracy in the 20th and 21st centuries through the words and deeds of our government. These libraries are among the country's finest examples of public archives, offering research rooms, interactive museums, and education centers to millions of researchers, students, and visitors each year. President Franklin D. Roosevelt's vision for his library created a process that has been followed by each succeeding president. He established a private foundation to raise funds for the construction of the library building that was then donated to the National Archives. Each library is supported by the federal government and in part by a presidential foundation. Situated around the country, presidential libraries reflect and enrich their local communities. They offer exceptional research facilities that are hailed for the personal service they provide to students and scholars. Each museum tells a unique story concerning the life and times of a 20th century and soon a 21st century president in the pivotal moments in history they faced. The library's extensive outreach to teachers and students is a powerful vehicle for civic engagement. As you know, 100% of all initial construction funding for the libraries, including the initial museum exhibit, comes from non-federal sources, the majority of which are private donations through the presidential foundations or their predecessor organizations. The construction of presidential libraries serves as an engine of economic growth in regional areas, revitalizing communities and guaranteeing continued revenue streams for millions of national and international tourists. Local chambers of commerce or state tourism boards estimate that each visitor to the library spends an additional $100 to $200, depending on the community, during their visit at local restaurants and hotels. Thus, with nearly 2 million visitors visiting our museums in 2010, the support to the community is significant. $15 million added to the economy in Abilene, Kansas, $43 million in Boston, $55 million in Austin, Texas. Equally important is the educational and cultural impact presidential libraries have on their communities. Over 500,000 people attended cultural programming, conferences, and various speaker series at the libraries in 2010. Where the country's finest historians, political leaders, journalists, and biographers came to locales where they would not typically speak. Moreover, the libraries provided educational programs for 350,000 students and 5,000 teachers. At a hearing last year at which I testified, there was some concern about the use of resources for educational and cultural programs. As I said at that hearing, the problem of civic literacy is real, Access to public records is a part of the solution to that problem, and no one is better positioned to provide access to public records than institutions like the National Archives. And I would add the 13 presidential libraries and 12 regional archive programs across the country. One of the greatest challenges at the National Archives is the backlog we experience in processing many millions of pages of records so that those records can be accessible to the public. Several of our libraries have over 90% of their collections processed. Our most significant backlogs are in the Presidential Records Act libraries, Reagan through Bush 43. In 2009, Congress approved funds for 25 new archival positions for the four libraries with records controlled by the Presidential Records Act. These newly hired archivists are a remarkably talented group trained on processing presidential records, and along with other streamlining measures, are beginning to make a real difference in the volume of records processed. We expect this year to increase our processing by at least 1.3 million additional pages and more in future years as these new archivists complete their training. Presidential Library Foundations provide the funding for museum education and public programs, websites, archives, support and digitization, marketing and other initiatives. These contributions have allowed the presidential libraries to be leaders and innovators in the National Archives and beyond. Let me provide a few examples. Presidential libraries were among the first public archives and the first in the National Archives to develop interactive websites and online document-based educational programming. The Presidential Decision-Making Classroom pioneered at the Truman Library is now a featured part of the education programs in several libraries and served as a model for our education programs here in Washington. The Presidential Timeline, created through support of the Johnson Foundation in a partnership with the University of Texas Learning Center and all of the presidential libraries, is an innovative teacher-student resource for digital assets reflecting the life and administration of each of the presidents. Because of the foundation funding, the Clinton Presidential Library became the federal government's first existing building to be certified at the LEED Platinum level. The George W. Bush Library will be built to LEED Platinum level as well. In addition to their ongoing annual support for the libraries, the foundations have contributed tens of millions of dollars to renovate our permanent museum exhibits. The Hoover, Roosevelt, Truman, Kennedy, Johnson, Ford, Carter, Reagan, and both Bush libraries have recently completed new permanent exhibits or are in the planning stage for a new exhibit. I'm supported in this partnership by my advisory committee on the Presidential Library Foundation Partnership. This committee is made up of representatives of the various presidential library foundations. Through these meetings, the public-private partnership can work to leverage our strengths and resources and resolve, or at least understand, how differences in our mission can sometimes strain our relationships. I meet with this committee at least twice a year to discuss and ask their advice on the activities of the National Archives, our strategic plans and vision, collaborative activities, funding, and legal issues that can affect the public-private partnership. The presidency is the one office selected by all Americans. Through our geographic disbursement, the presidential libraries are a positive force contributing to diverse communities, making history transparent, and strengthening the civic fiber of our nation. While I continue to believe in the importance of presidential libraries, it is my belief that technology will impact future presidential libraries. The size of digital collections at the Clinton and Bush 43 libraries is far greater than the paper records. In the near future, we can expect that a presidential library's collection will be mostly digital. Those documents acted on in a paper format will probably be digitized by the White House, and only those documents of significant intrinsic value will be saved in their original format, such as documents annotated by the president, correspondence with world leaders, and decision memoranda. Long-term preservation and storage of digital records is a delicate but worthwhile option. Nonetheless, I believe presidents in the future should continue to establish a presidential library if they wish to do so. Some collections may well be digital, but it is the curators, archivists, and educators who work in these libraries that make the collections accessible to all of our students and citizens. Thank you for this opportunity to testify, and I look forward to your questions.
Thank you. Mr. Putnam.
Chairman Micah, Chairman Issa, and members of the committee, I'm Tom Putnam, director of the John F. Kennedy Presidential Library and Museum.
I appreciate the opportunity to testify on behalf of my fellow library directors. We're so pleased that you have called this hearing and are honored to appear before you, along with David Ferriero, fellow historians, and especially with Anna Eleanor Roosevelt. Those of us who work in the presidential library system are indebted to her grandfather's vision, which led to the creation of the first presidential library. Franklin Roosevelt encouraged the country not to be fearful as he launched his presidency, during which, over time, we became the leader of the free world. Reflective of his infectious self-confidence, he valued transparency as an essential element of democratic government. Citizens must understand how their government works and have access to the documents that define their past. With the recent addition of the Nixon and George W. Bush libraries, our presidential library system, representing our 13 most recent former presidents, is made whole and has become a model for the world. Presidential libraries hold the memory of our nation. They're unique repositories that allow researchers and museum visitors an opportunity to relive the events that have shaped us as a people. Their educational programs create a more active and informed citizenry. I believe the current model works well and provides immeasurable benefits to our nation. We rest on four pillars. First, the private funds that are used to construct these buildings. Second, the federal funds that operate, maintain, and administer them. Third, the private support we receive from our respective library foundations. And finally, the revenue streams from our museums and related enterprises. One of the strengths of the present system is that it strikes the right balance between centralization and decentralization. Each library is built in a location determined by the president and his family. When visiting them, one is immersed in locales like Independence, Abilene, and Grand Rapids, in which our presidents lived and matured politically. Yet we're also guided by standards set by the National Archives that ensure our holdings are protected, our museums objective, and our access universal. Over the years, there have been calls to centralize the presidential library system. In 1962, President Kennedy was asked if he would locate his library in Washington, D.C. He made two points in his reply. First, he stated that through the use of technology, it would eventually not matter where a library was located. The Kennedy Library recently made JFK's vision a reality by digitizing over 300,000 of the most important documents and photographs of his presidency and audio and video recordings of all his speeches and press conferences, providing worldwide access to them via our website. Second, JFK replied in 1962 that by locating these institutions throughout the country, each could serve as a vital education center connecting the residents of that region to their national government. In addition to our robust local planning, presidential libraries often collaborate on initiatives like national issue forums, global traveling exhibits, nationally televised conference, and interactive web-based timelines. Here, students can not only watch the iconic speeches of President Kennedy and Reagan at the Berlin Wall, they can also learn of the quiet diplomacy President George Herbert Walker Bush engaged in after the wall fell in uniting that divided land, and view President Clinton reciting his favorite line from JFK's speech in Berlin, quote, "Freedom has many difficulties, and democracy is not perfect, but we never had to put up a wall to keep our people in." I would not be honest, Mr. Chairman, if I did not admit that the presidential library system, like our democracy, is not perfect. I'd like to conclude with two examples of the difficulties we face. The first is the question of the sustainability of the current model and the need to encourage innovation and entrepreneurship as the presidential library system ages and grows. The second is how we meet the need of releasing and opening materials as quickly as possible while also protecting national security interests. Ours is a young country with fewer coliseums and cathedrals than our European forebears. Sites which, like others, I visited as a college student, trying to understand the world my generation inherited and how we might make our mark upon it. This is the potency of presidential libraries in our land, serving as beacons to the world, shedding light on both the genius and the shortcomings of our history during what has been called the American century. Today, young people from all corners of the globe come to the Kennedy Library in Boston. They've often already visited the battlefields of Lexington and Concord. In our museum, they then listen to JFK's inaugural address, in which he states, quote, "We are heirs of that first revolution, and the beliefs for which our forebears fought are still at issue around the globe." My colleagues and I feel privileged to share the story of John F. Kennedy and his 1,000 days as president with students from Binghamton to Beijing, Daytona to Dakar, as they seek to understand the history of our nation and our world and look to make their mark upon it. This is why we undertake to preserve and provide access to these priceless historical treasures, for their ability to unite us as a country and a people, and to serve as the foundation on which new generations will, self-confidently, build our future.
Thank you. That's as close to a perfect finish as I've ever seen in a committee. Mr. Blackwood, next, you know the challenge. Five minutes.
Back to follow. Chairman Micah, Chairman Issa, members of the committee, I appreciate the opportunity to be here today. When Franklin Roosevelt established the first presidential library, I'm not sure even he envisioned how transformational they would become. His library and 12 others that have followed have had unparalleled impact on tens of millions of people. What he did for our country, our citizens, and most importantly, our school children, continues to pay dividends. Today, I will address the impact of presidential libraries and why they should continue as they are. I will argue that our mission should be multifaceted. Ultimately, though, everything starts with access, and the definition of access should be expanded. Over the years, presidential libraries have grown, changed, and adapted. This growth is due in good measure to the support we receive from our attendant foundations. Working closely with the Reagan Foundation, the current library is working well and is a successful public-private partnership. The foundation's support allows us to better serve the public. The Reagan Foundation provides hundreds of thousands of dollars in annual support and more than $50 million in capital improvements. This is on top of the $69 million they built the library. This support has had tremendous impact on three key areas: more than doubling our attendance, expansion of education programs, and heightened awareness of our facilities. The federal government's involvement and support is also critical. NARA successfully leverages the foundation's support, providing tremendous value for the government and the American people. With that support, we now serve many constituencies, broadly categorized into three groups: citizens, students, and scholars. Providing scholars access to the collection is critical. If there is one criticism, it would be that they want more material sooner, and I would concur. At the Reagan Library, our archives team has improved efficiencies, set new standards, and even though we are processing more than 1.5 million documents with shorter queue times, the research community clamors for more. Let's look at the impact of the use of our materials. A single scholar might publish multiple articles, books, or blog entries that will reach hundreds, thousands, perhaps millions of people. Should we just digitize everything then? Not so fast. There are practical concerns of funding, staffing, and processing time. Access through technology is one critical area that needs serious attention and significant investment. Why not just centralize? Tom presented a very strong case why presidential libraries should continue to grace different locations. I agree and would vigorously argue against centralization. While it is critical to move towards a goal of digitization, we cannot lose sight of working with the original materials. Historic documents can inspire, motivate, and cause you to think differently. When you hold President Reagan's personal diary and you read, "Getting shot hurts," or "Leaf Through the Day in Infamy" speech, it puts the researcher in a different frame of mind that can lead to new thinking. Access is more than just about the materials. Presidential libraries offer unique educational opportunities for hundreds of thousands of students across the country. So is access important to them? Archival access is not necessarily a priority for my daughter Abby's sixth grade class, but access to the museum, the curriculum, and the amazing Air Force One Discovery Center certainly is. Abby's class and thousands like hers want to and deserve access to these opportunities. So, should education be a part of our mission? Absolutely. Students represent the future, and learning about our history, the presidency, and civic engagement is critical for an informed citizenry. Presidential libraries offer an important avenue to access learning. At the Reagan Library, our approach is simple: the three E's. Excite, engage, and you will educate. That's what presidential libraries do. Our last constituency is the millions of citizens who visit us. They tour our museums, study our materials, attend our remarkable programs, and they too learn, all of which are different forms of access. So what is our mission, and what should the future bring? In summary, presidential libraries are repositories of historical materials, tourist destinations, museum, gathering places for civic and literary debate, educational institution, and places where communities learn. Our mission should reflect this diversity. Let's embrace President Roosevelt's vision and broaden it to the multifaceted definition of access. Furthermore, we need to be proactive with the use of technology. Presidential libraries are a unique institution that cause us to think, offer to look at, and perhaps question our government, help educate, and provide exciting opportunities for millions of people. I believe strongly they are vital. Thank you.
Thank you. Three beginning witnesses. Let me now introduce the three remaining panelists. We have first Dr. Thomas Schwartz, and Dr. Schwartz is the Illinois State Historian. He's involved with the Abraham Lincoln Presidential Library and Museum, and that's sort of a hybrid. It's not federally funded as far as its operation, but the state and private foundation, I believe, and he'll explain their operations and their relationship with the federal government. And I think they got a little federal money towards some of their recent projects. Then we have, we're honored to have Anna Eleanor Roosevelt. She chairs the board of directors of the Roosevelt Institute. It's quite fitting that we have one of the family members who's been actively engaged with the Presidential Library, and that also being the first of our libraries. And then we have Dr. Martha Kumar. She is a professor at Towson University, but also a distinguished, recognized presidential historian and also author. And we'll hear, she's going to sum it all up for us, so we'll hear from her in just a second. Let me recognize Dr. Thomas Schwartz again, the Illinois State Historian and with the Abraham Lincoln Presidential Library and Museum. Welcome, sir, and you're recognized.
Thank you. Chairman Mica, Chairman Issa, and members of the committee, I thank you for the opportunity to testify on the mission and future direction of presidential libraries. My comments will focus on the Abraham Lincoln Presidential Library Museum, its current relationship to the National Archives and Records Administration Presidential Library Museum system, and possible areas for further collaboration. This mirrors Abraham Lincoln's thinking when he declared, "If we could first know where we are and whither we are tending, we could then better judge what to do and how to do it." The Abraham Lincoln Presidential Library was created in 1889 as the Illinois State Historical Library. Its mission was to collect the written history of the state of Illinois, an effort that also led to sizable holdings concerning its favorite son, Abraham Lincoln. Discussions since the 1980s on how to build a new facility for the library moved toward the larger concept of a library-museum complex. A federal, state, and local funding partnership was created to finance the $167 million complex, most of that provided by the state of Illinois. The library, with its new name, opened in October 2004, and the museum opened on April 19, 2005. Of an FY 2011 budget of $12 million, the state of Illinois provides the largest source of revenue, with additional revenue streams provided by admission sales, parking and facility rental, and the support of the 501c3 Abraham Lincoln Presidential Library Foundation. The ALPLM has a staff of 66 full-time, 14 part-time, and more than 500 volunteers to maintain a 215,000 square foot complex under the administrative authority of the Illinois Historic Preservation Agency. With a total visitation of more than 2.5 million people from more than 100 nations since opening in 2005, the ALPLM has had annual attendance that surpasses any NARA presidential museum. Our programs range from temporary exhibits that have explored topics such as Lincoln's assassination, his views on agriculture, his actions as president-elect, to author talks, historically based theater offerings, teacher workshops, activities for young children, and conferences and symposia on Lincoln, slavery, and his times. Perhaps our most ambitious project is the Papers of Abraham Lincoln. Begun in 1985, this project has compiled and in 2009 placed online all of Abraham Lincoln's legal documents by case and issued a four-volume print edition of selections from his legal practice. Currently, the project is scanning every letter sent to Lincoln and every document he wrote, with the goal of placing the entire corpus of Lincoln's writings online. We hope to have the pre-presidential materials up by 2013 and the entire project completed by the end of this decade. Our interactions with the NARA libraries and museums have been few but friendly. Most requests are for the loan of Lincoln materials for special exhibits, several non-federal presidential museums being contemplated, and one to be added to the NARA system, have sent planning teams to see the ALPLM and imagine how its elements might be incorporated into their facilities. The ALPLM is known for being different from traditional museums, with its emphasis on a compelling narrative of Lincoln's life, supported by creative uses of technology and immersive environments that actually place you within scenes of Lincoln's life. All of the senses are engaged, and the interactivity the visitor discovers is not that created by technology, but rather the intellectual and emotional engagement he or she feels with the unfolding story of Lincoln's life. These techniques inspired the Mount Vernon Ladies Association, for example, to incorporate many of them into their new orientation center and museum. Everyone in this room acknowledges the importance of presidential libraries and museums as vital to preserving our national history while providing the general public with a broader and deeper understanding of our past. Moving forward, we see several areas of cooperation to consider. One, sharing resources to the traditional loan of materials, digitization of collections, and extending both to joint exhibits with one or more presidential museum partners. Two, linking to one another's website, utilizing satellite uplink to offer joint programs, and providing comparative study and curriculum materials to encourage the public to explore the entirety of our presidential history and not simply that of one administration. Three, continuing the larger dialogue with presidential museums outside the NARA system on issues common to all. Finally, striving to be entrepreneurial in finding creative funding solutions to the long-term solvency issues facing all presidential libraries and museums. As Lincoln aptly reminds us, the struggle of today is not altogether for today. It is for a vast future also. Thank you.
Thank you so much for your testimony, and let me recognize now, welcome Eleanor Roosevelt. Welcome.
Chairman Micah, Chairman Issa.
You may not be on there. Okay, but pull it up real close.
Okay.
Great.
Well, Chairman Micah, Chairman Issa, Ms. Norton, Mr. Cummings, members of the committees, thank you for the opportunity to testify before you today. My name is Anna Eleanor Roosevelt, and I am chair of the board of directors of the Roosevelt Institute, which is the nonprofit partner to the FDR Presidential Library and Museum in Hyde Park, New York. I have been a member of the Roosevelt Institute board for more than 30 years, and I have been board chair for a little more than a year now. In my professional life, I am the head of global corporate citizenship for the Boeing Company and serve as the company's representative on the board of the National Archives Foundation. The FDR Presidential Library and Museum is the nation's first presidential library. Prior to Franklin D. Roosevelt's decision to build the library in Hyde Park, the final disposition of presidential papers was left to chance, and much of that historical record has sadly been lost. President Roosevelt created an institution to preserve intact all his papers and related materials so that the nation could make use of the knowledge and experience contained there. The library's holdings include my grandfather's personal and family papers, the papers covering his public career at the state and national level, my grandmother's papers, as well as those of many of their friends and associates. It is a treasure trove of material that captures one of the most important eras in American history, the Great Depression and World War II, from many perspectives and directions. My grandfather, as you may know, was a great collector of birds, ship models, stamps, books, documents, and many other items. He once recounted, after being elected to be the librarian of the Hasty Pudding Club at Harvard, some advice that he was given by an old bookseller: never destroy anything. Much to my family's chagrin, my grandfather heeded that advice and kept everything. The result, as he himself put it, is that we have a mine for which future historians will curse me as well as praise me. FDR wanted to give these materials to the people of the United States and house them in an archive and museum built with private funds but maintained by the federal government. He felt it was important to keep all of his papers and artifacts together in a single collection. He also felt it was important that future generations who wish to understand him and his presidency should come to Hyde Park, to the community and home that helped shape him and meant so much to him high on the bluff above the Hudson River. Fully expecting to retire in 1940, work on the library began in 1938. But with the outbreak of World War II, my grandfather's plans for retirement had to be cast aside. Work on the library nevertheless went ahead as planned, and it was opened to the public on June 30, 1941, at the very time when most of Europe was suffering under the cruel dictates of fascist oppression. Taking note of this, my grandfather used the opening as an opportunity to remind the American people of how important history and the free access to information are to democracy. This latest addition to our nation's archives, he said, is being dedicated at a moment when government by the people themselves is being attacked everywhere. It is therefore proof, if any proof is needed, that our confidence in the future of democracy has not diminished in this nation and will not diminish. And he went on. The dedication of a library is in itself an act of faith. To bring together the records of the past and preserve them for the use of men and women living in the future, a nation must believe in three things. It must believe in the past. It must believe in the future. And it must, above all, believe in the capacity of its people so to learn from the past that they can gain in judgment for the creation of the future. As planned, the library was built with privately donated funds at a cost of $376,000, raised by a committee that was headed by a Republican, Waldo G. Leland. It was then turned over to the federal government on July 4, 1940, to be operated by the National Archives. By his actions, President Roosevelt ensured that his papers would become the property of the nation, housed in a library on the grounds of his Hyde Park home, also deeded to the nation upon his death, where they would be available to scholars. My grandfather's creation served as a precedent. The Roosevelt Institute supports the library's exhibits, its outreach and educational activities, and its special programs for its wide-ranging audiences. We understand our mission to be to preserve, celebrate, and carry forward the legacy and values of my grandparents. An important part of that mission is our partnership with the FDR Presidential Library. In 2003, the Roosevelt Institute joined the National Archives and the National Park Service in opening the Henry A. Wallace Visitor and Education Center, which serves as a joint visitor center for the Franklin D. Roosevelt National Historic Site and the Roosevelt Presidential Library, and as a conference and education center. It is also a valuable community resource used by hundreds of nonprofit organizations for meetings and events. The Wallace Center was constructed through a unique public-private partnership between the National Archives and Records Administration, the National Park Service, and the Roosevelt Institute, which raised substantial private funding in support of this project. The Roosevelt Institute supports all four of the library's main program areas on an ongoing basis: archives, museum, education, and public programs. The library's research operations are consistently one of the busiest in the entire presidential library system. The library serves thousands of on-site researchers and more thousands of researchers who contact the library through written requests, mostly via email. The Roosevelt Institute provides grants and aid to researchers demonstrating new scholarship in study of the Roosevelt era, as well as assisting the library in purchasing new books for the collection. We are working with the library to secure the necessary funding to digitize and make available online some of the most important documents in the collection. Since the opening of the FDR Libraries William J. Vandenhoevel Special Exhibitions Gallery in 2003, the Roosevelt Institute has provided more than $1 million to support changing exhibits in this gallery, along with enhancements and improvements to the library's permanent exhibits. This money made it possible for the library to purchase high-quality exhibit casework for the Special Exhibitions Gallery and to present many special exhibits. The Institute has also provided over $5 million to create an exciting new permanent exhibition at the FDR Library. This new exhibition, the first complete renovation of the museum's permanent exhibition in the library's history, will employ state-of-the-art technology to bring the story of Franklin and Eleanor Roosevelt to new generations of Americans. It is scheduled to open in 2013. The Roosevelt Presidential Library offers document-based, curriculum-centered education programs for students ranging from the second grade to postgraduate level, including the United States Military Academy at West Point. The library conducts teacher workshops each year, attended by hundreds of teachers from across the United States and from more than half a dozen countries. There is only one full-time education specialist who is provided by the government. The Roosevelt Institute provides the remaining support to the Roosevelt Presidential Library's Education Department annually. This support is critical to the operation of the library's Education Department, as it provides the funds to hire 4 part-time New York State certified retired teachers and 1 part-time education clerk, and to produce quality education materials that are used by students and teachers in the Hudson Valley, the tri-state area, and across the United States. Public programs and community outreach are at the core of the library's mission. The library offers a host of innovative programs and events to the general public each year. In sum, the work of the FDR Presidential Library and Museum, and of presidential libraries generally, is critically important for retaining and advancing the public's understanding of the nation's history and for making that history available in communities across the country, communities from which our presidents have come. The FDR Library and each of 12 other presidential libraries tell the stories of the eras in which their presidents lived and the persons who rose to leadership within them. They make these stories available to thousands of Americans who do not have the opportunity to come to Washington, D.C. and to the National Archives on a regular basis. It is important to remember, as my grandfather truly believed, that these investments are not support for memorializing specific individuals, so much as they are investments that preserve, protect, and promote the broader scope of the history of this country, all of the dimensions of that history, the good and the bad, the successes and the challenges. As such, and with all that we can learn from the many generations of Americans who have gone before us, the support of the federal government provides the presidential libraries represents an investment not in our past, but in our future. I thank the committee for the opportunity to testify today.
Well, thank you again for your testimony. And now we'll recognize our last witness and our historian and presidential scholar, Dr. Kumar. Welcome, and you're recognized.
Yes, Chairman Micah, Chairman Issa.
Might pull that up real close.
Okay.
Thank you.
Is that okay? Yes, Chairman Micah, Chairman Issa, Ranking Member Norton, Ranking Member Cummings, and members of the committee. Thank you for the opportunity to discuss presidential libraries and their importance to students, scholars, and government officials. As preparation for my testimony, I wrote political scientists who specialize in the presidency and asked them how their students use presidential library, and in their work as presidency scholars, what difference presidential libraries make to their research. The responses came from all over the country and even from Canada, with a uniform refrain of how important presidential libraries have become for those of us who examine executive leadership as well as those studying individual presidents. My informal survey established several points about the use of the importance of presidential libraries to students and scholars alike. First, presidential libraries are a national and regional resource for those studying the operations of government and individual presidents. Having the libraries located in 9 states in most regions of the country has brought the presidency to the public. The libraries have become a valuable part of many undergraduate and graduate programs and allowed students to open a window on the presidency without traveling to Washington. Students nationwide can afford to travel to one or more of these libraries and have rich experiences. For one professor, a charter bus trip to the Truman Library means having his students consider the Berlin airlift and the decision to drop the atomic bomb. Scholars depend on presidential libraries as a key resource for their own writing. The presidency section of the American Political Science Association has an annual award for the best book on the presidency. In reviewing the winners for the 20 years that the prize has been given, at least 75% of the books draw heavily on presidential library materials. Presidential libraries are a resource as well for those in government. The 9/11 Commission made heavy use of presidential library materials. In recent Supreme Court nomination hearings, Senate Judiciary Committee members and staff reviewed presidential library files to see what actions and recommendations John Roberts and Elena Kagan had in their service in the Reagan and Clinton White Houses. White House staff in all recent administrations have called up materials from presidential libraries. As successful as the library visits of the faculty I've polled are, the professors singled out the archivists as the key to the success of their trips to the libraries. With millions of records in each library, sifting through for relevant materials is a challenge for resources, for researchers. The archivists fill in this gap. Second, presidential libraries are important to what we know about the presidency as an institution and about individual presidents. Materials in the library allows us to test common assumptions we have about the presidency, how it operates, and what particular presidents did while they were in office. The president's daily diary, many of which are available online, track the minute-by-minute movements of a president from one room to another. The diary records who was in meetings and when they come and go. Through such careful tracking, we know who was with a president when he was considering particular policies, and we have the documentary records preserved as well. One professor used the daily diaries to test the idea that President Reagan had relatively short work days by comparing the length of the workday of several recent presidents. It came out that President Reagan worked a similar workday to Presidents Johnson and Nixon, and a longer one than Presidents Kennedy and Eisenhower. Audio recordings of meetings are also valuable for understanding important decisions and how they played out, as one can see in the recordings of President Kennedy's meetings on the Cuban Missile Crisis, which are in audio. Third, cooperative ventures can be an aspect of the model for future libraries. There are many ways in which presidential libraries can work together with those studying the presidential actions. In some cases, there are groups beyond the library foundations that provide funds for researchers to travel to one or more libraries. Students, too, can work as interns or on work study programs to provide needed work in appropriate areas in the libraries. An example of a cooperative venture between scholars and presidential libraries is the White House interview program. The program is built around interviews with key former White House officials to help prepare those coming into the White House in 2001. The materials were also used in 2009. The interviews are housed at individual libraries, with many of them available online. The project demonstrates what is good for scholars can be also good for those coming into the government and for presidential libraries. Everyone benefits when people, students, scholars, and the public, learn about their government and its leaders.
Well, thank you for your testimony, and I want to thank all of our witnesses. Again, I think this is a rather historic joint hearing between two committees, and the first time that we've approached the subject in this manner. Again, the important mission of our presidential libraries and their current status. What we'll do is start with a little round of questions, and I'm going to ask our archivists a couple to start. Right now, a big question in Washington is spending and national finances. You don't have a huge budget for the libraries, but I see in approximately $77 million is the FY10 estimated cost. Is that correct?
76.2.
Okay. And of that, it looks like operational costs, operations and maintenance was $27 million, programs $35 million, and I guess some of the renovation costs were about $9 or $10 million. I had the opportunity to visit the Kennedy Library, and I don't think this is planned for my visit, but they had a big bucket in the and it's a beautiful atrium, but there's a big bucket and water coming down. And they assured me that they had renovation and repairs underway. Do we have a capital program for all of these libraries? I guess the submission goes through you and initial approval. Is that correct?
That's correct. Let me preface my answer by a story about the Kennedy Library. I.M. Pei was the architect, and I was there at the opening. And that atrium sitting out there on the water, a visitor came up to I.M. Pei and said, "Aren't you afraid it's going to leak?" And he said, "Of course it's going to leak." An architect. We have a repair and renovation budget within the National Archives, and we have a master plan, space master plan, that identifies all the needs across all 12 of the facilities, soon to be 13 facilities, with an estimate of expenditure each year. That will be severely reduced in the coming year.
One of the other things I noticed, I was quite shocked to see the, all the exhibits in all the libraries are remarkable, but I was really a bit surprised to see the condition, sort of an aged condition of the Kennedy exhibit. In fact, I mentioned to Caroline Kennedy and to our departing Patrick Kennedy representative, the need to update some of those. Do we have a schedule for updating some of those?
There's been a huge focus, especially at Kennedy, on digital activities to get the as much content out into people's hands around the country first. But there's also planning around updating the exhibit space, the current exhibit space.
Mm-hmm. I heard this Roosevelt talk about that, and I'm not sure the stage. Do we have an does anyone look at, again, the overall picture of putting some of this incredible information on digital or using the latest technology in all of these libraries?
Every one of the presidential libraries has been investigating, has done something in the area of digitization and long-term planning for as much content as we can afford.
Now, back to the financing. I understand different libraries have foundations and they're supportive. Is there any estimate you could give to us as to what additional funds are provided or what percentage of additional programs are underwritten by the private sector?
I can get you that figure. I don't have it off the top of my head, but each one of, I think it's safe to say that each one of the presidential libraries is pretty creative, innovative, and entrepreneurial in identifying private support for a number of their activities.
Then I noticed, too, that I was looking at the admissions and the activity from visitors for the different libraries. It seems to taper off, again, as the presidents fade into history. That leaves, again, a bigger burden on the federal government to underwrite the operations. And also I noticed at some of the libraries, the Department of Interior is involved. Their costs and figures are not included in your budget. How much, do we look at the overall long-term mission, the reduction in admissions, and then contributions from other agencies?
That's certainly something that is in my consciousness, and you're right, there is a relationship between the date of the presidency and the attendance. On the Park Service collaboration, those sites where we have the homestead, that's where there's a history of a Park Service involvement in the site.
Okay. Then we've got Mr. Schwartz had an opportunity to visit there in Illinois, and that's a private state operation. I also was informed the federal government had promised some help on the capital side and only met about half of its contribution. Maybe you could tell us how you're funded and how a federal commitment on kept affects your operation and your budget.
The original funding plan was that the state, the two structures came to a total cost of $115 million. That was the estimate. And the idea was that the state would provide $50 million, the federal government would provide $50 million, and the city of Springfield would provide the property and the remaining amount. It ended up that the federal government came forward not with the grant fully funded, but a matching plan. And so state regulations require for a construction project for all the money to be in place before construction begins. And so the state actually had to then finance the full amount. And we were, of that $50 million match over 5 years, we were able to recoup about $35
million. Okay. Ms. Roosevelt, you had mentioned that you're in the process of digitizing some of the records. Is that also with federal help, or is that a private activity? And where do you see the federal government helping you in the future, again, as far as protecting some of these national assets and treasures?
Well, that particular project, I'd have to refer to our librarian to make sure, but I know that whenever the library has a program need, we are partners with them, and we work with them to discover what is the need to produce the result that is best for the library program. And so we often do co-funding on projects, and I would assume that the that would be part of the digitizing project.
Mm-hmm. Finally, have any of you worked with the Library of Congress, or you have joint efforts going on with the Library of Congress? Yes, Mr. Schwartz, maybe you could tell us that relationship.
The papers of Abraham Lincoln, right now, the last two major repositories of Lincoln's papers that we need to scan are those at the Library of Congress and the National Archives. We've finished the scanning of the collections out at Archives 2, and we're now in the main archives, and we're at the Library of Congress, and I think we hope to wrap up both those scanning projects in the next few years.
Okay, and the noontime, or when we recess, we'll hear from the Librarian of Congress, and this afternoon some of the questions that we can't get to with the members of the panel and other directors and those active with some of the other presidential libraries that have joined us today, we'll have an opportunity. So if you think of a question, or we can get more to the answer. I saw it from Ms. Roosevelt in that symposium that starts this afternoon. So with that, let me yield to Ms. Norton.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Ferriero, I have a question for you. You are, of course, aware as a federal agency that we are in the midst of making large cuts in federal agencies. We have to make many of them. In your testimony, you noted that the Clinton Library is platinum lead, and that the Bush Library is also expected to be platinum lead. And of course, in our committee, we we promote this because of the enormous savings that can be documented. In this case, the savings would be to the taxpayers. Have you advised, or do you think it would be important to advise those who build these libraries in light of the fact that the operations are paid by the taxpayers of the United States, that these libraries should be built to the highest LEED standards available?
I certainly would agree to that, and I would suggest that any future library that we build will be built to those specifications.
Thank you very much. Again, a question going to the need to make savings, particularly in the year or two headed, there's great concern here about savings. However, even the Deficit Commission warned about doing cuts that were too stringent this year and advised to wait a couple of years lest we send the fragile economy back. So people like me are looking for things to cut that meet the necessity to cut, but that may not have that effect. Now, I note, in light of the fact that the taxpayers pay for the operations, in applying the cuts to the archives, and let me preface this by saying I've sat through hearings where the archivist has raised my very serious concern about the underfunding of the archives and your ability to maintain the precious historical papers of the United States. Shouldn't the cuts be applied as little as possible to your official work, your official documents, with perhaps the libraries and their operations taking somewhat more of the cuts, since that's operations alone? I mean, if you had to distribute the cuts, and that's who's going to have to do it, you cry up here about the maintenance of, and well, you might. We all should shed tears about the maintenance of this repository. Then you've got to decide where the money goes. Well, there's some powerful people in the libraries who want their operations just as they are. There are not so many powerful people speaking for the papers that you complain you don't have the money to upkeep. So how would you distribute this funding?
Well, I would just remind you that those papers that are sitting in those 13 repositories that we call presidential libraries are federal records, and they are my responsibility.
I'm asking about the papers sitting right in the National Archives.
They are part of those records, the federal records and presidential records.
I'm asking about the operations, Mr. Perry. I wish you'd answer my question directly. I'm not asking about the records. I'm asking about when you got to apply funds to operations, and you can make cuts in operations versus cuts in official documents, whether they are, as you say, in the presidential libraries,
and what,
or whether they are here in the District of Columbia. And I can answer to my question.
And what I'm trying to explain is that my approach to the cuts treated presidential records and federal records with the same level of...
Except that wasn't my question. My question was operations, cuts in operations versus cuts in
those
records.
Cuts in operation were applied equally across federal records and presidential records. So the restrictions that I described...
You can't be serious that in the operations of the archives... Or of the well, let's take your own operations. You would give as much weight to whether or not there's going to be another security guard as you would to maintaining the records themselves.
Protection of records, whether they're federal records or presidential records, are equally
important.
I'm
not talking about the difference between the two records. I'm talking about the operations that the taxpayers pay.
But they pay
for the presidential libraries.
The taxpayers pay for that security in the presidential libraries.
That is what I'm talking about.
And I'm
And they paid for other operational matters in the presidential library.
That's right.
So I'm not talking about the records, I'm talking about the operations.
And I'm saying that my approach to security, in this particular case, security of the collections, whether about security guards, would be the same in a presidential library as it would be at 700
All right, Pennsylvania Avenue. I see I'm not going to get an answer to the question. I'm not asking about security. Operations has to do with a whole lot more than security. I gave you an example as whether you have one more guard or one less guard. But I would be very concerned if you just were to find it as easy to apply funds to operational matters as to apply funds to the maintenance of these very important historic documents. And I will bear that in mind the next time you come before this committee. Mr. Blackwood, I note that you were at one time director of the Ronald Reagan Presidential Library and were serving simultaneously as the executive director of the private Ronald Reagan Presidential Library Foundation. Now, there could be complications in holding these two positions. Now, you only hold the federal position now. Is that the case?
Correct.
Do you feel more comfortable holding only the federal position, in as much as you won't have to resolve possible conflicts of interest?
Yes, I think the current model, the way it is, with the director serving only in that capacity, is the best model.
Now, that's a matter of policy, isn't it, Mr. Fiaro?
Yes.
Is that is a policy that you made, or is it a policy that a prior archivist made?
It was made prior to my arrival, but it's one that I support.
Don't you believe that that should be the policy of the government, not only the policy of the archivist, who may change from time to time and therefore change the policy?
It could very well be.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Let me recognize the co-chair of this joint hearing, Mr. Issa.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Ferriero, following up on what the gentlelady from D.C. said, you do have one luxury, I'm presuming, and that is that when there are cuts in your budget, some of those expenses, if you're not able to do them at the 13 presidential libraries, are going to be taken on by the foundation side. So in some cases, there'll be no reduction in service, even if you've had to trim some of your duties, right?
In some cases where there are resources available, it is possible.
And so that's an inherent benefit to the American people, that you can operate fairly austerely there while those records are maintained, protected, and as Ms. Roosevelt said, digitized at somebody else's expense, not the federal government's.
The issue is the level of activity that can be sustained. We have backlogs in most of those presidential libraries in terms of basic processing.
Okay, well, I'm going to go to the luxury of riches for a moment. Mr. Blackwood, your library is expanding. I had the honor of being on the airplane that was delivered just before September 11th to the Reagan Library, or at least to the airport, and I've now seen it repainted in all its glory, all of it basically at no government expense. I think we paid for the fuel to fly it out there. But my understanding is we saved money because we didn't have to do an annual maintenance on it if we delivered it to you that day. The Reagan Library is a wealthy library. There is just a tremendous amount of support for foundation donations to the Reagan Library to continue his legacy. Should we be looking from a standpoint of government at spreading that wealth, at looking and saying for the long-term sustainability, not when there's 13, but when there's 33 libraries, to have some sort of a scheme to make sure that the dollars are available from a common foundation or in some other way, a a non-direct government appropriation to help make sure these libraries are all maintained at a high level. And I'm going to you first because you're sort of the richest library at this particular time, present here today, perhaps.
I don't know if we're the richest, but I am very fortunate in the support that the Reagan Foundation has provided the Reagan Library, because I think it benefits all citizens. Whether you visit or come virtually, it's a benefit. And I do recall the trip because I was on the plane with you, and it's extraordinary. But that's a perfect example of what the foundation has done. It was $35 million that they support to build the Air Force One Pavilion. In addition, they maintain it on a regular basis, so there's zero cost from the government standpoint on that. In addition, there was another $9 million that they raised and spent for the Discovery Center, $15 million that they spent for the recent renovation. As it relates to an overall foundation, I think that's a concept that should be developed. You'd have to go to each of the foundations to see what their support might be, because I liken our organizations to a family. We have 13 kids and similar, the same parents, but different needs and different wants and different expectations. So I think it's worthy of looking into.
Ms. Roosevelt, perhaps you would be not the oldest, but the longest standing of the libraries. Your grandfather's legacy lives on, and as a result, there's no doubt people who contribute. But do you believe that we have a likelihood that the poorer stepchildren of the presidency will over time either end up as wards of federal appropriated dollars or simply fall into disrepair?
Well, I can imagine such a situation. However, I think that there will always be interested private citizens who care about history and who care about its preservation. But I think
but that's the reason for my question, ma'am, is if we have interested private citizens, what I was speculating on is from this side of the dais, if we want to not rely on appropriated funds for X library, none of yours, but let's just say X library, should we be looking at a national nonprofit entity as an umbrella for contributors who want to contribute to the maintenance of presidential libraries so that stipend would be available to wherever it was needed, recognizing that early after a president's presidency, the funding tends to be good. Matter of fact, it tends to be really great while he's still in office, it turns out. And that's a separate subject of investigation. But then, as time goes on, often the people who were in the cabinet and who are part of that group that does the fundraising, they pass on, and unless there's somebody like you in the family, it becomes very hard, or like Caroline Kennedy, to continue their level of fundraising. So my question, and it would be a question really to everyone on the panel sort of sequentially, and it would be my last question, is should we, on this side of the dais, be looking at an umbrella organization, recognizing that we can't force these contracts to be modified, but we certainly could create the equivalent of public broadcasting, but public support that was a central one that would then be available? Because I, for one, assume that the taxpayers are not going to be any more willing in the future to appropriate than they are today, and yet your needs will continue to increase. So that's really the question for each of you that, starting actually with Martha, each of you that have looked at this problem that will go on for 200 more years of our history. Please, Doctor.
For political scientists, we are particularly interested in comparative research. So for us, going to several libraries is important. And so whether it's a big library or, you know, whether it's Hoover in West Branch, all of them are important. How to fund them, that's beyond me. I'm a user who wants to see all of them funded. But I do think, as I was saying in my testimony, that I think that there are ways in which academics can be involved in trying to do things like create oral history projects, because often libraries don't have enough funds for that. And maybe do internships, work study programs to train people to help archivists go through papers.
Thank you. anyone else that wants to comment on this basic concept of 13 foundations versus a 14th, if you will. David?
Well, it's an interesting concept to contemplate. We now get, with the amendment to the Presidential Records Act, with the Bush 43 library, 60% of the endowment now will come for support of the libraries. It's interesting to contemplate a percentage of the endowments from across the those libraries going to a common fund that would accomplish what you suggest. We also should factor in the fact that we want to digitize as much as possible. So in the future, is there a need for physical access to papers? Could papers be centrally stored somewhere in Washington, perhaps, because people have digital access? So it's another option.
Anyone else? Thank you. I yield back.
Thank you. Let me yield to the gentleman from Maryland and the ranking member, Mr. Cummings.
I think I want to direct this question to Dr. Kumar and to you, Mr. Fierro. You know, as I listen to this discussion, the thing that bothers me is that these are records of presidents of the United States of America. These are records that it shouldn't be a luxury to maintain them. This is a part of our history. When we travel to Greece and places like that, although our country is far younger, we learn about the history, and I guess that's why they have the recordings, and so that people 500, 700, 800 years from now can appreciate this history. And I'm just wondering, do you have an opinion as to whether, you know, I understand how we've set it up with the foundations and everything, but do we have an obligation in your minds, and particularly as an archivist, to address these issues and these records as something that government must be about the business of doing and must be about the business of safeguarding, as opposed to, let's just say, for example, the foundations fell on hard times. They weren't able to do it. I mean, I just wondered if you have an opinion on that. Yes, sir. And then I'll go to you, Ms.
As I was trying to explain earlier, I feel as responsible and as passionate about those presidential libraries as I do about the records of the agencies that are also in my custody. We have an obligation to ensure that they are taken care of, processed, and made available to the American public.
And Ms. Dotskuman?
In my own research, it's made an enormous amount of difference to see what it is that presidents were doing at a time and bringing records together, like working in the Reagan Library, I was working on some of his speeches, and to see, you could see a speech text, but then going through the notes that the president himself made on it and the changes that he made a great deal of difference as to what he did. But in the views that one had of his own work, and I think it takes multiple sources and also being there. Students, I think, in particular, would be the ones who would suffer, because you bring in people that go into young people who come into the environment of a presidency, like in the White House Decision Center at the Truman Library, and get to experience what kinds of decisions the president made using documents that were classified at one time. And it's through things like that people learn what a government does, the benefits of a government, and what presidential leadership is all about.
Let me cut you off right there, because I have a limited amount of time. But let me ask you this. My major concern, I have several concerns. One, that we guard these records, that we make them available. And tagging on to something you just said, Dr. Kumar, I want to make sure that the kids in my district have access to those records, mm-hmm. and I want them to be able to, they may never be able to visit a presidential library, not as a kid or even as a young researcher, but I want them to have access, because that's where I think we take our dollars and we stretch them so that more people have the benefit of them. And I think it was Mr. Putnam was talking about the county library doing all these wonderful things to make access more available. And I was wondering, do the other libraries have similar kinds of plans or programs and that kind of thing? And Dr. Farrell, I'm just wondering, when you are dealing with these folks, do you ever say, or is there an avenue for you to say, look, how can we make these records more accessible to, and with the web and all these wonderful tools that we have now that I didn't have as a kid. But I'll tell you, the idea that some kid in Mr. Gowdy's district in South Carolina, which is where my mother and father were former sharecroppers, if that little kid could sit there and look at go on the internet and whatever and access this library, well, he may not be able to make it as a kid, but certainly he'll learn and perhaps he'll be inspired to go later on. So I'm just wondering, how does that play? And maybe I see Mr. Putnam seems to be anxious to say something too.
Well, we did that just last week in that all these assets that we digitized were really meant more for the scholars like Dr. Kumar. But what we developed was an interactive where students could actually sit behind President Kennedy's desk. It's called the President's Desk, and Caroline Kennedy helped us to launch it. So that a student in your district or a student in South Carolina could literally feel what it would be like to sit behind the President's desk, and then they can link on various interactives that tell the story of John F. Kennedy and our country's history, literally listen into the conversations. And as the archivist mentioned, all of the libraries collaborate. We have this interactive presidential timeline that every library is involved with to be ensure that it's not just the libraries that have these additional resources to make these materials available. But one thing related to a question Congressman Issa mentioned, even though some of us have foundations that have more resources, really it's as your question indicated, it's the federal government's responsibility to preserve these records, to secure them, to process them, and declassify. None of us get support from our foundations to do that. They recognize that that is a federal responsibility. What they help us to do is do some of these other interesting interactives.
And the archivist is a huge proponent of digitization. My goal is to make as much as we have possible available in just the way that you described it, because I am firmly convinced, based on my own experience, that if it isn't online, it doesn't exist in the minds of those kids.
And government itself benefits from the library materials and keeping them, because you don't want people to make the mistakes of the past, and the only way they're going to learn is to really find out what happened, and answers are in those records. And in every recent administration, they've called upon the presidential libraries to give them materials that relate to particular instances that they're trying to figure out what happened in the past. And as I'd said earlier, the 9/11 Commission relied heavily on materials from presidential libraries.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Let me yield now to the gentleman from California and the subcommittee chair, Mr. Denham.
First question I have is to Dr. Schwartz. The Lincoln Presidential Library is not part of the National Archives Presidential Library System. Can you describe what advantages, disadvantages that gives you, and the support that you would like to see received from the National Archives?
Well, obviously our biggest obstacle is that Lincoln's records are scattered. And so by doing the Papers of Abraham Lincoln, we went to hundreds of private, public repositories as well as individual collectors in order to try to reassemble the record. The advantage that the current presidential library system has is that those records remain intact. But Lincoln being a 19th century figure, you didn't have the Records Act, which mandated how these records were to be maintained and stored. And so we're having to actually do this process of reassembling something that has been fractured and scattered to the four winds. As I indicated, we began as a research facility, research library, which had a broader mandate to collect the written history of the state of Illinois. when we were in search of getting funding for a larger facility for the library, it was also clear to us that the public had this great desire. They were seeing these records not as research materials, but really as items for inspiration. For example, the Gettysburg Address, the Emancipation Proclamation, the 13th Amendment. And so in order to satisfy that need of the public seeing these items more as artifacts, historical artifacts for inspiration, that's where the museum component came in. What we do, though, is in the museum, we have a specific effects theater called Ghosts of the Library, which makes the connection between what the research library does and the historical content that they find in the museum. And being a public institution supported by the state of Illinois, we encourage people in the museum side to go visit the library side and to examine some of these records for themselves. So our biggest problem, obviously, is Lincoln has been dead for almost 150 years, and there is no group of wealthy donors that typically funds presidential libraries and museums while the president remains alive. However, Lincoln still has such an iconic position within the leadership of this country that we do have a strong donor base, and we are constantly looking for ways to expand that.
So advantages or disadvantages compared to, say, the system that Mr. Blackwood enjoys in California?
He has the advantage that many of President Reagan's close associates and donors remain alive and supportive of the institution. And he also has an advantage of having one of the most popular of modern presidents. And that's a great advantage. Our advantage is that Lincoln still has is popular within the broad general audience. But it's more difficult for us to take that popularity and to translate it into actual donations and membership support.
And how about receiving funds locally from state and local organizations versus being part of the federal system?
Of being in the capital city of Illinois, which is maybe 118,000 people, it does not have a broad corporate base to draw upon. And we're in constant competition with trying to go to Chicago, which has that kind of corporate donor base to compete with other cultural institutions located in Chicago. And so it's a challenge. But again, we are not only reaching out to funding sources within Illinois, but nationally. And I think that's the only way that any cultural institution can hope to survive.
Thank you.
Thank you. Pleased to recognize the gentleman from Pennsylvania, Mr. Altmaier.
Thank you. And I very much appreciate all of you being here, even those in the audience from other libraries and museums around the country. And Ms. Roosevelt, it struck me when you were speaking that we all, as the chairman said, feel a personal interest in this as Americans, but you, of course, have a very personal interest in that particular library. And you said in your very eloquent remarks that one of the purposes of the museum and the library is to carry on the legacy and values of your grandparents. And it struck me in the context of what we're looking at today with regard to the funding of libraries and the ongoing support. There's the initial construction, but then there's the ongoing maintenance and operational expense. And it led me to think the different roles that these libraries and museums play. There's the library, the research component, which we're focused on today, which thankfully, because of technology, more people are going to have access over the years. But there's the museum side, which is the library themselves making a determination, this is how we're going to present this former president. This is the light in which we're going to cast upon that president. And then there's the programming side. And museums have different missions with regard to programming. The Carter Center, for example, has a very specific programming mission and reason for carrying on that mission. And I wanted to ask the archivist, in that context, under the current presidential records law, there's no ability to edit documents or prioritize them or in any way politically, one way or the other, manage them. Is that correct?
That's correct. And one of the great things about having the records is that we let the records speak for themselves. So right. Attempts at whether it's a user or other people trying to twist history, we have the documentation to back it up.
And there have been very recent examples of libraries that have opened up their doors to researchers who have written very decorated books, Pulitzer Prize winners, that were not entirely flattering to the subject, but that documentation is there, and you can interpret it however you want. However, on the museum and programming side, the concern, not a concern, but I think it's worth discussing in the context of today, is when donors give money, especially when the individual may still be president or has very recently had been president, what's the motivation of the donor? Rhetorically, but what something we're concerned about, the difference between public money, taxpayer money, and private money. And I understand foundations versus, you know, corporate or individual giving. But I would ask Mr. Putnam, Mr. Blackwood especially, how do you see the difference between the mission of libraries and your responsibility to portray the president fairly and in a very public way? But what's the expectation when private money comes in versus public money, and what would be the difference in the way libraries in the future would carry out their museum function?
Right. Well, I very much appreciate the support that we receive from our foundation, but it always comes with the understanding that it's the federal employees who make the final decision. So, for instance, in our museum, it's a federal employee who is the curator. She writes the text, it gets approved by me. There's no influence at all on the foundation. Similarly, our foundation helps support our digitization project, but it's clear that it's the chief archivist who decides which collections get digitized and the priority. So I think that should be the model, that the foundation can receive funds, but the federal employees, again, are the ones who protect these records, help interpret them, and are in charge of how we portray those stories to the public.
I would agree with my colleague, Mr. Putnam, and we are similar at the Reagan Library. While the support that the foundation provides us is extraordinary, we work hand in hand for that balance, and we are very much a part of that process.
Thank you. I would ask Dr. Kumar, with regard to the funding issue, there have been some presidents, well, all presidents, they're humans, and they have things that they would like to see portrayed and things that they would like to see perhaps not shown for the public, at least not emphasized. Do you have a concern as a historian of the ability for libraries to water over or gloss over issues that perhaps might be something that the former president would want to see? So some of them have had very public failings. Do you think that public versus private money can in any way lead to influencing the way that the museum operates and the programming operates?
Well, I think that that presidents understand there are going to be a lot of warts in their administration, and that everything that they've done is not perfect. And they accept that. And they probably accept it a little more than some of their relatives do. But there's probably a real difference among families, for example, in the support for opening things up. For example, in the Johnson Library, Lady Bird Johnson and the two daughters were very much behind opening up all the tape recordings before President Johnson even had wanted them to be released. And I think, you know, the archives knows what its mission is, and the people that are the directors of the library. Now, you know, sometimes there'll be conflicts, like, say, in the Nixon Library. But you're going to find, for example, there's going to be an exhibit on Watergate that is going to look at Watergate in a fair manner. And so I think in the long run, the documents do speak for themselves, and that people who are the archivists are very interested in protecting documents. And then they know well which ones are important to decision making, and I think those ultimately went out.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Let me yield now to the chair of another of our subcommittees of jurisdiction, gentleman from South Carolina, Mr. Gowdy.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Blackwood, Ms. Roosevelt was very eloquent in noting that libraries are repositories for information that is both good and bad. Dr. Kumar just used the word fair. Those phrases are inherently subjective, so how do we reconcile advocacy with history in determining what is historically significant, what is good, bad, and fair?
First of all, historically significant, I think there's the obvious ones that you can point to in each of our administrations, but there's going to be those that are interpretive, just like what is fair and what is right and what should be. And I think it needs to be a collaborative effort, and I think that's what each of us, all the presidential libraries, work towards, is working with the foundation, working with the documents, the realities of the administration to put that forth. But because we're humans, you're always going to have that variance. But I feel very proud with what we've been able to accomplish, and quite frankly, with my colleagues. And we're very fortunate to be able to have that support to be able to do that.
Dr. Schwartz, is fundraising during the term in office problematic? And regardless of whether you think it is or not, do you advocate public disclosure of donors?
Obviously, that's not an issue that we have a problem with.
That's why I ask you.
But in terms of you know, the current system, I think more transparency is better than less.
And the current system, for those who may not be familiar with it, is what?
I believe that it's up to the individual foundation of whether those names are released or not.
Mr. Ferriero, I was privileged to go to the archives recently and was thoroughly impressed with your staff and your hospitality. And I, given my background, was particularly interested in the safety and what you've done with respect to theft and vandalism. Can you speak to that and whether or not you think the safeguards are sufficient as is?
A culture of vigilance is something that I bring to the archives from my previous lives in research libraries. This is not something that you can say that you've done everything that you possibly can to protect the collection. It's something that I worry about all the time, and I will continue to worry about it and ensure that we do everything possible to walk this fine line between protecting what we have and making it available to the American public. And it's a challenge every day, because anyone who wants to either steal or destroy or alter a document and is really serious about it, there are ways of accomplishing that. And our job is to ensure that they don't have those opportunities.
Yes, sir. Dr. Kumar, would you be willing to weigh in on the funding, whether or not the database of donors should be public, whether or not there should be any Chinese wall, so to speak, between the donors and the office holder? What system would you advocate?
Well, I'm as a scholar, I'm certainly a believer in transparency, but I think it ends up depending upon what the agreements were that people made earlier, And so to make records available now, I think it's difficult for various libraries. I mean, you can start a pattern for the future about what you expect in terms of transparency.
Would you advocate a pattern that did not allow fundraising during the term in office?
I think that's a difficult one. I'd have to. I'm not convinced that the kinds of efforts that have been made at this point in the last administrations has made any difference. I don't see where it's where donors got anything. You know, whether they got appointments or something like that. I'd have to be convinced because I don't see that that's been the case. I see the concern that you have. But it may be that transparency would be the answer during the period of the administration.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Very good questions, Mr. Gowdy. I had a couple of those on my mind. Back to the archivist, just to assure everyone, we did have the situation. I think Mr. Altmaier talked about twisting history, but. The question of access from that a president would have, as we had with the Berger case, with some of his aides, and I think you said you have put in place as many protections as you can, but you can't absolutely guarantee. Is that the case?
That one was actually relatively easy to address, in that those kinds of records, presidential records, when they're being reviewed or used by a member of an administration, will be done in a SCIF, a protected area, and with someone watching. That's
well. Again, we need to make certain that we have as many protections in place. And the other Gowdy and Altmaier attention to, I think the. Other question of the donors, there's a lot of popularity for a president when they're in office, and as they're leaving office, they have a lot of supporters, and then it dramatically drops off. It's a lot harder. But I think the conclusion reached by everyone was, again, as transparency, to encourage transparency in that process. We may have more discussions about that this afternoon. Just a couple of quick things. Again, to the archivist, we have, in time and space, we have a dozen libraries, presidential libraries and others, and they are now looking at maintaining their records and files and digitizing them. Is there a standard format that's been developed for all of that information? And the other thing, too, for those that may be watching the hearing, is there can they access through the National Archives, or do they have to go to each independent library? Maybe you could explain the setup we have, again, for a coordinated effort to make that information and those digitized records available.
The user has options to go to the individual library or to go to the National Archives, or the first line of defense for most folks is Google. And these records are searchable, retrievable through Google, so they have lots of different options.
And the coordination with the Library of Congress, we're going to be meeting with the librarian in a few minutes. That's also coordinated as far as format access.
There are national standards that we're using in the archives that are the same national standards that we helped develop with the Library of Congress. Mm-hmm. We do a lot of digitization, preservation work with the Library of Congress.
Okay. Mr. Roosevelt, in closing, I had a great opportunity when I was in high school to attend a debate tournament at Emory University, and I heard your grandmother speak at a and it had to be about 1959, I believe, at Emory University. Never forget that experience, which seeing you today and reflecting on that experience, here's a question I don't know the answer to, is we covered the presidents. What about the first ladies and their records? Is that adequately covered? And some of, I guess, be your grandmother's
records and documents. Are they also covered adequately?
Well, I believe that the records of my grandmother's activities are the most complete at the Roosevelt Presidential Library. I'm not sure that the First Ladies are covered as extensively, perhaps in some of the more recent libraries have. But surely, as these wives of our presidents have acted on behalf of the government, their papers are important for the understanding of how we operate.
And then maybe the archivist and Mr. Putnam had his hand up.
I can just speak for the deed of gift library. So we recently negotiated a deed with Caroline Kennedy for all of her mother's papers. We're in the process of processing those, and they'll be open next fall. So it was contingent, though, on Caroline Kennedy giving us those papers in the same way that the Kennedy family gave us the records of President Kennedy. But again, that's because I operate a deed of gift library.
Uh-huh. Any standardization of that, Mr. Archivist?
We would, I think, across the presidential library system, the goal is to acquire and make available in the same way we do the president's papers. And it's a very timely question. Tomorrow at American University is an all-day conference on the First Ladies.
Great timing. Any members have any other questions? We will continue. We're going to adjourn in just a second this hearing, formal hearing. We'll reconvene at 2:30, and we have many distinguished leaders of some of the various presidential libraries. We couldn't get everyone on the panel. We'd be here till midnight, but we will have an opportunity for everyone to participate at 2:30 in the Cannon Caucus Room. We'll reconvene in a more informal setting and hopefully a productive setting, too, both for members of Congress and also for those who are engaged on a daily basis with operating and maintaining and looking at the future of our presidential libraries. We hope to, in our discussions this afternoon, to continue focus on the relationship between the federal government and our presidential libraries, both the public and private. We also want to discuss strengthening partnerships among the libraries, both federal and non-federal. And then again, I think it's important that we look at facilitating the relationships that we have, various connections, technology, working with academia, other libraries, and again, both the National Archives, the Library of Congress, and each of the individual institutions. So I think we could have a good discussion this afternoon, an informal setting. Everyone's invited to participate in that. And there being no further business before the joint committees on transportation infrastructure and government reform and oversight, this hearing is adjourned. Thank you. For those also, I might say that are going to the Library of Congress, it is raining, I was just informed, and we will escort those who are going over, if you'll meet outside the hearing room, just as we conclude now. And then again at 2:30 in the Cannon Caucus Room for the symposium. Thank you.